I am teaching RNA sequencing. Today we're going to talk about RNA sequencing as a tool overall. I'm going to show you today, hopefully, how to analyze RNA sequencing data from a model organism. What are we going to be doing here? So the first question really is, why are we using RNA-seq? I know that all of you who do RNA-seq have probably been told that you're doing RNA-seq because you don't have a choice because it's on your grant, or because it's the most exciting thing that you can do, or that it gives you the most information. What does that really mean when you're doing RNA-seq in a model organism? So it's not cheaper than microarrays. Microarrays give you a wealth of knowledge about the sequenced organism. It's not as mature yet, it's getting better, but there's still more tools to analyze microarray data than there are RNA-seq data. So why on earth are we all in this room? The first and most important one is that there's more information in sequence data than there is in hybridization arrays, right? A hybridization array assumes that you know everything that you need to know about an organism. With model organisms, we're getting closer, but we're certainly not everywhere. There have been new papers every couple of years or every couple of months that have found new forms of RNA, new genes, new something based on RNA sequencing data that you never would have found using spots on microarrays. You also don't have to have a perfect reference. So we're using model organism. Model organism is kind of a misnomer in that it's not a perfect genome. It's just close. So every time you do RNA-seq, you have a chance to improve the reference and make it just a little bit better. Finally, and we'll talk more about this tomorrow, if you don't have a model organism, if you don't have a good reference, but you have something, you can use RNA sequencing to improve the reference. And if you really don't have sequence data, you can do it from scratch, even though you don't know what organism or what the genome of your organism looks like. That's where we're starting. We're going to look at a whole bunch of stuff today, but really what we're going to do is we're going to show you the basics of analysis using two different experiments, or at least pieces of two different experiments, in eukaryotic organisms. The idea here is to give you a feel for the tools and a starting place to begin with an analysis just using the tools that we give you. It's by no stretch of the imagination supposed to be viewed as a complete set of tools that you're going to be able to publish with just taking these and applying them to your samples. There's a lot underneath the surface, and I'm going to say it a bunch of times as we go through this. So how does the web page work? It isn't quite accurate. There are a couple times where I have put actual bash code like this. However, anytime there's a callout box, something like this, or something like this, it's a command. Either it's a program that we're writing, or it's, so these are supposed to be programs. This is something that you're going to be typing on the command line. If I expect you to see output, it's going to be in a little box with an info tag next to it so that you can see what it's going to be. Straightforward, right? No problems? The green and red stickies are there for you to let me know when you're having problems. Rania here is our TA. She's going to be running around if you have problems while I'm teaching, trying to help you. The only way she knows you have a problem is if you put up a red sticky. It's a whole lot easier than you standing here like this, like we're back in fourth grade. So go ahead and please try to put the sticky up if you're having trouble. Usually, we only do this when we're in the exercise portion. So if there's not a sticky up, I assume that you're working on something. If there's a green sticky up, I assume that you've done whatever I've asked you to do and you're ready to move on, so it gives me an idea of when I should keep moving forward. If you put a red sticky up, something went wrong and you need help. Easy, easy, hopefully. So what are we doing when we do RNA-seq? The first assumption here is that you have sequence data. I'm not going to talk anything about what you need to do to get good and valid experimental design or enough replicates or anything else. I'm going to assume that you have sequence data. So what we're starting with is a couple of samples with several conditions, and we're going to go through the workflow of what we need to do. This box is not indicative of the importance of the work, because if it were, this box would be the size of a page, and we have to scroll a couple more pages down before we get to the next thing. So what's this? QAQC. Why do you need to do QAQC? The sequencing center said that the data all looked good, so you don't need to do anything, right? Right? Wrong. Sequence data comes off of the Illumina machine. When you get a report back from the sequencing center that says the data look good, it means that it actually sequenced whatever data, whatever fragments you gave them. If the fragments are smaller than the insert size or the expected insert size or the read lengths, you're going to have sequence data read past all of your fragments into your adapters, which is very, very bad for RNA-seq and for just about anything. If your fragments are of poor quality, you're going to have poor quality reads in your data. Poor quality reads are usually going to fall into one of two categories. Either the whole read is going to be bad, in which case you need to throw it away before you start your analysis, or the end of the read has started to get bad, which you need to get rid of so that that read can be useful in your analysis. Usually if a read is complete, but the last half of it is bad, it's not going to be analyzed properly. So the most important thing, in my opinion, everyone will stand on a soapbox and tell you something, and some of them will disagree with me. They're wrong, but they might, is that you have to do your QAQC. You have to make sure that your data are good before you start. If you don't, you're going to waste at least a day running through your pipeline, coming to the end, and then spend probably several weeks trying to figure out why your data don't make any sense, why your analysis, your differential expressions are weird and confusing, and it's very likely that it will all come back to here. You need a reference genome if you're going to do read-based and alignment-based RNA-seq, which is all I'm going to be talking about for the next 2 days. You have to choose the right one. You have to download it. Then you align your reads to your reference, count the reads, and go through analysis depending on the type of organism. If it's a model organism, you can go to straight differential gene expression. If you have a semi-model organism, you need to build a new gene model and then go to your pathway analysis. Although really what you do is you build a new gene model, redo your alignment, come back through, and then go to your pathway analysis if you want to. Make sense? Sort of? Okay, so that's what we're really going to talk about.